All right, we will go ahead and get started. My name is Carly Regan. I'm going to be the moderator for this first panel. I would first like to thank our panelists for taking time out of their days to be on our Chemical Engineering and Materials Science Career Exploration Night panel. This event is being recorded and will be made available to your ASU 101 instructors in a few days. In case you become closed out of the meeting, please log in again. We have panelists from 4:30 to 5:30, followed by a 3-minute break. Then we switch out the panelists for our 5:30 to 6:30 panel. As the moderator, I will start with the prepared questions directed to some or all of the panelists. Panelists, I will use your name so you know the question is directed toward you. If you would like to pass on answering a question, please feel free to say pass, add, or agree with someone else's comment or statement. Students, your attendance is being recorded based on your registration information and the length in the meeting. The attendance list will be given to your ASU 101 instructor. Use the Q&A box on the black Zoom bar to type career-related questions for our panelists. You can make up questions or use the questions from your workbook. If the question is directed to specific panelists, please include their names in your question. Feel free to type in your questions now. Our Q&A moderator will read your questions shortly. Panelists, please take yourself off mute, but remain off video, and we will go ahead and begin. All right, so the first question is for all panelists. To help the undergraduate first-year student audience know a bit about you as they formulate their questions, please give your minute or two-minute professional tell me all about yourself pitch, including how your formal education is used in your current or previous roles. Let's start with Daniel.
Sure, thank you. So my name is Daniel Sinclair. I graduated from ASU last year from the School of Materials Science and Engineering, and I'm now starting my PhD education at Purdue University in the School of Materials Engineering here in West Lafayette, Indiana. I became interested in research starting with an internship my sophomore year, the summer between my sophomore and junior years, and since then I've been doing a lot of work studying the corrosion of non-ferrous alloys. That's a field that's been really engaging to me, being able to kind of combine the basics of material science with a really applications-focused field that not a lot of people are engaged in. My time at ASU prepared me for that by giving me a lot of the specific research skills that I needed, such as computer methods and math methods for engineering, statistics, and a lot of materials characterization that requires kind of a hands-on skills-based as well as a fundamental understanding of physics. I think that kind of covers everything I've done, but I look forward to hearing some questions from the attendees.
All right, thank you, Daniel. And Sienna, can you tell us a bit about yourself?
Yeah, hi everyone. I'm glad to have you join. So my name is Sienna Storino. I'm a senior in chemical engineering. I'm pretty involved on campus. I also work for the Fulton Career Center, which is being brought by this panel tonight. I also work for the Entrepreneurship and Innovation School at ASU. And I'm also some of your guys' section leaders, so you might know me from that. I've had two previous internships in chemical engineering, one in the coatings industry when I was a sophomore. And then last summer I worked in the semiconductor industry as well. So I have a couple of different job experiences that hopefully I can help you, current student, but I'm looking forward to hearing your guys' questions. Thanks, guys.
Great. Thank you, Sienna. And then Amanda, will you tell us a bit about yourself?
Hi, everyone. My name is Amanda Levinson, and I graduated in 2018 with my bachelor's in chemical engineering from the University of Washington in Seattle, where I was heavily involved in biomedical undergraduate research focused on infectious disease diagnostics, and was also heavily involved in women engineering leadership organizations. And for the past just over 2 years, I've been working at Intel as a process engineer. I've held two different roles, one in facilities and one in manufacturing, focused on developing semiconductor processors, where I use my chemical engineering background frequently to understand interactions that are taking place on semiconductor materials and to troubleshoot equipment that deal with liquid chemicals. As a professional, I have continued involvement in the Society of Women Engineers at the Phoenix professional level and also doing outreach with ASU for events like this and other universities in the area.
All right, thank you, Amanda. And Robert, will you tell us about yourself?
Well, as far as a career experience, I guess you could say I'm at the opposite end of the spectrum. I am retired from 3M Company after 35 years. First joined 3M in 1981, probably before many of you were even born. But I came to 3M with chemistry and chemical engineering degrees. Have a long storied career there in a wide variety of roles, everything from new product development to developing new processes for industrial manufacturing, which involved developing test methods, qualification plans for new products, a lot of statistics and tools such as design of experiments. And in the latter half of my career, I was actually the corporate leader of 3M Quality, Lean, and Six Sigma throughout its worldwide operations. Though I am retired, I am also currently a part-time employee with the local company called CEI LabForce, the Center for Entrepreneurial Innovation. And specifically, I am working with them to build a quality curriculum to help new entrepreneurial startup companies become successful in their whatever field that they are producing products in. Typically in here in Arizona, that's somewhere in the healthcare industry, but I have a large, diverse background in all types of different industries because 3M is so diverse itself and global. I continue to help coach and mentor aspiring young engineers in my role with ASQ, which is the Society for Quality, and also SWAE, S-W-A-E, the Southwest Alliance for Excellence, who are the local contingent of the Baldrige criteria, which is used to be named the National Quality Award, but its purpose is to help companies and organizations share best practices from what are designated as role model companies so they can bring best practice applications into their company. And I look forward to the opportunity to meet with all of you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Robert. And now this next item is also for all panelists. Please tell us one piece of career advice or career observation you'd like to ensure our students who, keep in mind, just started their ASU education a few weeks ago here. And then we'll go left to right again. So Daniel, if you'd like to answer that.
Sure. I think one piece of advice that I would give, this is something that really helped me find a path I was passionate about, is to keep an open mind when considering topics you're interested in. I think it's good to experience a lot of different types of engagement and involvement on campus, take a lot of different classes, and just in general, try and do everything once so that you know when you finally do pick a career path, it'll be something that stands out among all the others.
All right, thank you, Daniel. How about you, Sienna?
Yeah, going kind of off of what Daniel just said, I would encourage you all to get involved early and get involved in something you're passionate about. So whether that be research or whether that be a on-campus job, Epic, Spirey, anything that you are interested in, get involved early so you can start building your resume early so you can land those internships. And then hopefully that will progress into a full-time job. It's definitely my biggest advice for the career kind of path of it.
Awesome. Yes, that is great advice. And then Amanda, do you have any advice you'd like to share?
Yeah, I think following on the previous two panelists, as you keep an open mind and try different things, don't be discouraged if you don't like something, because I think not liking something is just as informative for your career as when you find something that you love. And to also kind of stray away from the idea of trying different things, I would also say that you know, building your technical skills and engineering acumen is really important, but I also want to emphasize that exploring things outside of engineering is totally okay, especially if it's something you enjoy. Once you get out of school, I don't think you'll have as many raw learning opportunities as you do in college, just right at your disposal. So don't be afraid to take that psychology or Spanish class, or do a club that gives you leadership opportunities that may not be hands-on and mechanical.
Absolutely. Thank you, Amanda. And Robert, would you like to share any advice?
Well, I echo a lot of what's already been said about finding your passion. Don't be afraid to experiment outside of your comfort zone. You're pursuing a technical degree, but I wholeheartedly support branching out into some of the liberal arts. Try different things. I can remember way back when I was still in college or grad school. I was involved in a lot of different school or campus activities, doing some volunteer work, even participating in some work study events. And your potential employer is going to be looking for that diverse background because they want to see that you have the ability to work with people. So if you have an opportunity to work on teams. And then I found it very beneficial in my career path to also have a background in some liberal arts such as grammar or English. Comes in very handy for when you have to write your technical reports and you have to kind of, let's quote unquote, say dumb it down for management. And you want to be able to communicate that. So the communication skills are very important. And back when I was going to college, I was even dabbling with the college radio station. I was one of the DJs. It just got me completely away from the technical world and more around music and appreciation for the arts. And I got more exposure to the community at large that way than I would have if I just concentrated in a deep dive of the technical background.
Great, thank you so much for you all for your feedback on that. So now we're gonna open it up to the audience's questions. Let's see here. So looking through these, some of these have already kind of been answered with the responses. Let's see here, we'll go with this one. What are some of the duties for chemical engineers in their work? And this is open for any of you to answer.
Well, from the world of global manufacturing, chemical engineer, obviously you come into a role as a young quality professional or young engineering professional, and you'll be involved with teams to help scale up new products from a bench type of development to a smaller pilot plant operation, and then finally transfer all that knowledge to produce this new product on a full-blown manufacturing line. That's kind of the traditional world of a chemical engineer. However, you will also find yourself tabbed to participate on teams, maybe even lead projects. So any experience you can get around project management, how to manage people, time, resources, budgets, you're going to find yourself very immersed in the world of finance, because you've got to, as part of the new product scale up, is to conduct cost analyses. Companies aren't going to want to invest where they're not going to get a healthy return. You've got to be able to put together cost models and look for alternative sources of supply. You're going to be working with other disciplines, such as quality and safety, industrial engineering. You're going to work to understand what are the requirements of regulatory agencies. Happens in today's environment with Industry 4.0, a lot of big data, neural networks, data mining. All of that type of experience will come into play as an incoming chemical engineer.
Thank you so much. Any of the other panelists want to respond to that? Okay, so we'll go on to the next question here. So let's see, and Sienna, how about you? How did you find internships? Or actually, this is for anybody. How did you find internships and your first job?
Yeah, I can talk on it first. How I found my first internship, well, let me tell you, there's a few ways. So my favorite few ways is obviously Handshake. Handshake, people on Handshake or the recruiters on Handshake are looking for ASU students. So Handshake's a great way to go about it. First, we are seeing an email. I don't know if that's supposed to be there, just to let you guys know. Yeah, Handshake's a great way to look at job internships. LinkedIn's another great way to find different positions, and you can also see how many people applied. Indeed, there's a bunch of different websites. Personally, when I was a sophomore, I really didn't know what I was looking for or really, frankly, what I was doing. So I typed in chemical engineering internships on Google. I applied to a lot of different positions, and I actually ended up finding one at a pretty big company, which I think I got a little bit lucky, but that was the first way I found mine. And then the second internship I got at a NXP, you'll see them, I think they have another panelist at the 5:30 to 6:30 session. I actually was at Rapid Resume Review, which is a event that we usually hold for the Career Center. And one of the recruiters saw my resume because I just showed him briefly. And then he liked my resume and hired me that way. So sometimes it can be, you know, connections, or like 7 out of 10 jobs you find through connections. So making sure you're building your connections at ASU by getting involved, and then also just the standard job search kind of go hand in hand with that.
All right, thank you for that. And then this next question is specifically for Amanda. Amanda, what does your typical day-to-day look like at Intel?
That's a great question. I guess in short, my day-to-day varies, which is part of what I like about the job, that I don't get bored doing the same thing over and over. But I think my job is a mix of project management, data analysis, and live troubleshooting. So from a data analysis standpoint, I spend a lot of time writing scripts and looking into parameters about the manufacturing tools that I own as part of my job scope. As far as project management, I'm working with construction people, stakeholders in supply chain to manage improvement projects. So whether it's quality, output, time, or the things like that. And then live troubleshooting. As a manufacturing engineer, we're responsible for making sure that our tools are always up and running so that we can meet customer demands. And so when something goes wrong and it's malfunctioning, we actually have to investigate what mechanically, electrically, or chemically went wrong. So it could be getting, quote, down and dirty and investigating the tool right in front of it with some of the technicians, or again, using some of our data analysis skills to understand recent trends and then make decisions about those issues.
All right, wonderful. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. All right, this next one. What was the factor that made you enter the chemical engineering field? Daniel, did you want to answer that?
I can't answer as a chemical engineer, but I can say for material science and engineering, at least, that I was really interested in the way that the field sort of brought together the actual applications of research along with the fundamental science of research. The fact that your basic knowledge of how material is structured can be used in a very short amount of time to produce some really effective improvements on everyday engineering items or specialized designs.
Perfect. Thank you, Daniel. And then Robert, did you want to respond to that on the chemical engineering side? What made you enter the field?
Well, I came via a twisted route that wasn't my original plan. When I was growing up, I really had it in my heart. For whatever reason, it was just became just like my destiny. I wanted to get into internal medicine. So obviously I went down the path of biology and chemistry. And as I got into the chemistry, and became more aware of the difficulties of getting into med school and needing a backup, during my time in undergraduate. That's when I explored more liberal arts and other science disciplines such as physics and biochemistry, and took an interest in chemical engineering just because I was interested in some of what are considered the core topics of chemical engineering, separations, thermodynamics, reaction engineering, transport phenomena. And that, coupled with my inquisitiveness, and I liked working with numbers, so problem solving also came into play. And it just seemed to be a natural fit. And I think the other thing that really helped me lean towards chemical engineering was I grew up in Minnesota, and that's the home of 3M Company. Their worldwide headquarters is in St. Paul, Minnesota. They have a huge research and development campus. They employ over 15,000 people there. If you grew up in Minnesota, everybody knows about 3M. Everybody wants to work for 3M, A, because they pay well and great benefits, but also because they're so large. They're worldwide. They have operations in over 65 countries. During the time I was with 3M, we grew from 84 manufacturing plants to over 200 in all areas of the world. So it was a great way to meet new people, learn new cultures, scale up products from one country into another. And it was just a great opportunity.
Wonderful. Thank you, Robert.
Okay, and it looks like we have another great question. This could be for anyone. And the question is, how do you go about applying for your first lab or internship without much relevant experience beforehand?
Well, I would say as your first internship, it's not really that important that it's very tightly tied to your area of study. It's more what your first internship should be more about is gaining experience and skills of using your problem-solving skills and application of critical thinking. And what you want to get out of your first internship is just to have demonstrated the capability to work on teams, the demonstration of that you are self-directed. You don't need that day-to-day work assignment. You can work independently. You have that inquisitive nature. You're curious and want to solve problems. So that's what a potential employer is looking for. Are you direct self-directed? Are you dedicated? Are you self-reliant? Do you get up and have no fear of approaching people to learn new techniques? That's really what they're looking for as your first internship.
Great. And what about one of the other panelists? Did you have any advice for students?
Yeah, so for your first internship, obviously, if you get it as a sophomore, you're only going to have about a year under your belt to get any sort of relevant experience. Like what Robert was saying, just showing a company on your resume that you are, lack of better words, a go-getter, you're hardworking, and you are well-rounded, I think is the word I want to use. So let's say, next semester you get involved in EPICS or you get involved in research or anything. You're showing a company that you do have that self-starter initiative attitude, and you're not just kind of I'm going to get an engineering degree and then someone will hire me because I have an engineering degree mentality. You are a go-getter. You are goal-driven is what you're showing employers on your resume by doing these extra things outside of your academics. So getting involved, I think, is still a silly answer for getting your first internship or anything like that.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you. Next question, I think that this one might kind of play well off of the last question, but that is, do you think that undergraduate research is worth the experience to then help get an internship in chemical engineering?
I can answer that one. I am fully behind undergraduate research projects. When I was an undergraduate at the University of Minnesota, I had a unique opportunity to work with a professor on a project that he was working on. It was a National Science Foundation grant, and he was working on bioluminescence as a potential energy source. And so it kind of fit with my chemical engineering. It also kind of fit with my biology and microbiology. And so that was just a perfect fit, but it was an undergraduate opportunity to work on a research project. I got my name on a paper. It was something that was tangible, and I could demonstrate my participation and the role that I played to further demonstrate that I had those problem-solving skills and just the fact that I had the scientific approach to problem solving. It was a great, great opportunity. So if you have that opportunity, I would certainly try to take advantage of it. It's not to say that an undergraduate research project is the only way to go. Even volunteering or working on the self or on a work study type of project will help demonstrate at that very introductory level that you're goal-oriented and self-directed.
That's a great answer. It's very helpful. Wonderful. Another question, this one is for Amanda specifically. And the question is, how did SWE help you in college and further?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I guess just to elaborate on my introduction, I was part of SWE all 4 years of college. And like I mentioned, I'm still part of SWE. And through that, I held several leadership positions where I was planning events primarily focused on undergraduate and graduate student professional development. And I think it helped me in a variety of ways. I think at the core of what I was doing, it helped me take ambiguous situations and learn to create a plan and execute. So when you're planning an event or trying to improve a situation for a group of students, you know, all you say is, I want to increase job opportunities for students, but how do you do that? So it required that I seek out the right university staff and professors to help support us, figure out the financial resources, figure out what companies we wanted to engage in some of those events that we were building, and really piece together a lot of parts and see things through all the way from ideation to execution. And I think that's a really important transferable skill that you can take to any kind of job setting. And then SWE, just as an organization, I think helped me build my professional network. So I got to meet a lot of people outside of chemical engineering to inform just a holistic view of engineering, and also meet several company representatives and other existing professionals while I was a student that helped facilitate job opportunities or helped me figure out what path I wanted to take in my chemical engineering career. So I'm a huge proponent of extracurricular activities and getting involved, again, whether it's engineering or not, to build those skills outside of school and meet other people.
Wonderful, thank you. Okay, next question is from Luca, who would like to know, and this is for anyone on the panel, what do you think is the hardest part about your job? And on the other hand, what is the easiest part of your job?
Well, for me, as I'm retired from 3M, but I'm still now working part-time / contract, and I volunteer a lot, the hardest thing for me is to say no. Because once the word gets out that here's an individual who's reliable, they're committed. When they commit to deliver something, they follow through. And in today's environment where we're all putting in so much time and there are so many distractions, there's so much information coming at you, it's easy to become distracted and to fall through on some of your plans. But if you can limit your time, if you have good time management skills, it will go a long way to helping you not only achieve your personal and professional objectives, but also to make sure that you have time for yourself to continue sharpening your saw, to have fun, to relax, seek those stress outlets, because Lord knows we're all heavily under much more stress in today's fast accelerating change world than ever before. So you need that release. And that would be my comment.
Thank you.
I could throw an answer from kind of the academic research side of work. Sure. I think one of the toughest things, both in my undergraduate career and already starting graduate school, has been starting new projects. When you start a new kind of area of research, you end up with a lot of literature review to do, a lot of planning, and even when you can combine all these past ideas that have been sort of published and put out there, you can end up with a whole bunch of questions that you want to answer all at the same time, but being able to take those key points and find out how you can learn the most quickly and how you can actually design experiments to answer those new questions is pretty difficult, but is probably the most important part of any form of research.
Okay, great. Thank you. So I've seen this question come up a couple times in the Q&A, so I'll go ahead and read this one. This one's from Osama. And the question is, do you think artificial intelligence and machine learning applications will replace chemical engineering, and why?
I can throw out a material science answer.
Sure.
I don't think replace is really the right word, because at the end of the day, like as much as machine learning can point you in the right direction, you have to get there yourself. But definitely in research, there's a whole bunch of work towards automating material selection, using simulations and machine learning side by side to definitely replace a lot of smaller scale experiments that might end up taking all of your time if you didn't have a more rapid computer-based solution for it.
I would say that you also need that human component, because you can code into an AI device to say, okay, we're interested in looking for these types of outcomes, these expectations. But it's pretty hard to write code to be able to look for things on the perimeter that you weren't expecting, but yet hold some unique opportunity or potential for a whole new line of chemical reactions or a whole new product line. You need that human interaction. So I see AI as more of a supplement, because you're still going to need that human perspective of, you know, the way to innovate is through dreaming and thinking of what could be. And I don't think the AI technology is there yet to deliver that. You still need that human component.
Great. Well, this might be a good time to ask the next question, which is, how do you see the industry changing over the next 10 years? And this could be in chemical or material science and engineering.
Can answer that. I don't have a whole lot to add to that, but I think, and I actually saw this towards the end of my senior year at UW, I think the industry is really moving towards data science. And again, using data science to supplement the industry. I think chemical engineers coming out of school, I think there's a greater expectation for people understanding computer coding and a lot of the large scale data analysis. So I definitely think that's where we're headed in the next couple of years, and especially in the educational space.
Okay, great. Anyone else have any ideas about how the industry might be changing in the future?
Well, it's been changing in the design space of modeling for many, many years, but it's not to the point now where artificial intelligence that modeling can be done so much quicker. But just It's just learning how to code and how to build the models and look at material flow and reactions. That if you can take your chemical engineering scientific approach and couple that with building AI models, you can run much smaller experiments that are much less expensive, more economical for the company or the organization, and you can run them so much faster, run all these different simulations, Monte Carlo simulations and other types of simulations to predict a future path or future direction that I think it's still a lot of world to be explored looking at chemical engineering.
Great. Thank you for that response. It's very helpful. All right, next question is, I think that this one is especially helpful. I get some questions related to this fairly often as an academic advisor. Questions from students about changing majors. They're wanting to know, have you changed your major before when you were in college? Or also, if you feel like you might be in the wrong major, what advice would you give to a student who is thinking about changing majors?
I never changed my major, but I sure have thought about it many times. It's definitely a challenging program, but I think my best word of advice is stick with it. The ASU program is very focused on like kind of water and energy treatment and balances for the most part. So I guess my word of advice is there's a lot more to chemical engineering than what you're taught necessarily in thermodynamics and heat and mass transfer. So if you are passionate about something in the industry, so let's say you're really passionate about medical devices or pharmaceuticals or even nuclear energy, just stick with it. There are a lot of opportunities. And if you don't necessarily like Calc 3, just move on, keep pushing through. And I think you will be well rewarded, hopefully, in the end.
Great.
I guess I would offer that in the prior career exploration night presentation I was involved with a couple weeks ago, one of the other panelists who was a graduate of ASU had professed that he changed his major 9 times while at ASU. So it's not like it's a rare event, it happens. And his perspective was, he learned so much more about himself and what he really wanted to do. He always thought he wanted to go down one path, but he discovered after exploring the opportunities and what was available and what's out there, that his passion and things that really motivated him were on a completely different track. And a word to the wise, when you get out into the work world, if you're doing something that you love, it's not work. Whereas if you feel compelled, well, this is my area of study and I've got a degree and now I've got to go down this path, you may find after 2 or 3 years, it's really not what you want to do. It's just not what you have a passion for. And I've discovered in my personal career with 3M, over the course of 35 years, my passion shifted dramatically. I would say in my first 10 years, it was very, very hard skills, technically oriented. But then as I got into working with products and processes and customers and marketing and sales, I learned that there's a whole world out there of opportunity. And I had some keen interests, maybe passion, around working more on the soft skill side. And my passion now is more coaching, consulting, and developing young talent. It's not about me, it's about them. And I just love being up in front of a room and teaching or helping coach and consult on with a small team. It's not the more that the true technical skills, it is about teamwork and process-oriented thinking. So don't be afraid to dip your feet in the water and maybe dabble in some other areas, perhaps not some non-science areas.
Wonderful. I think that's great advice. Thank you.
All right. So this next question is good. So what are some personal qualities that are important in this occupation? This is open for any of the panelists.
I don't think this is necessarily just for chemical engineering, but I definitely want to stress that it's important to be a collaborative team player, to have good communication, and overall just be a nice person to work with. I think regardless of whether you're a chemical engineer or someone in finance or accounting, you want to enjoy the people you work with, especially when you work a lot. So make sure to extend a hand to help other people, take advantage of learning opportunities, and show that you're willing to put in extra time to do a good job.
Thank you. Any other panelists want to add to that?
I would say to build off that, I think the best personality trait for an engineer or any sort of science-based field is to just have a real passion for learning and always sort of treat yourself as a student before an expert. These fields are changing more and more every day, and all the research and industry work that's coming out of them always makes something new that you can learn and use to improve yourself. So being able to learn from mentors, being able to drive your own learning and skills growth is hugely important as a character trait.
Yeah, I think those are all very good responses, and I would just add to that. Be willing to experiment, think out of the box, be flexible. Definitely bring your expertise, but then also demonstrate that you're willing to listen to different points of view, and you're willing to deviate a little bit. And as I said, be a team player, have great communication skills, and not just verbally, but also listening. As the saying goes, we were all born with two ears and one mouth for a reason. So be a good team player, a good communicator.
I like that. Perfect. So I'm seeing a couple of questions related to this. So it's regarding, do you think it's necessary to go to graduate school, or is it preferable to enter the workforce after a bachelor's degree? This is open to anybody.
Well, I can see both sides. If you truly have a passion for the science, the technical side, I think then obviously it's a no-brainer. You want to continue to build on your expertise and you know, become a specialist in that area. So graduate school is really perhaps a given at that point. However, if you find that you want a broader perspective, you're fine being a generalist, and you can quasi-specialize in some area. It's not necessary to have a master's degree to go into industry. In fact, some areas might prefer someone who's not as structured and disciplined. They're more willing to work outside of that little box that they put you in. Definitely bringing graduate experience or a master's degree into the workplace sets you up for a larger initial benefit, income benefit. You know, you get a little higher salary bump just coming in as a master's versus a bachelor's. But I from personal experience know that just bringing in the degree that I had at the time and then demonstrating my flexibility, I moved up that career path very, very quickly and got some real nice salary perks along the way. So it's not a hard and fast rule.
I would say I definitely agree with that perspective, that there's two completely different ways to kind of view your work as an engineer. But definitely if your goal is just to have a career that you enjoy in the field, there's no requirement for that. There's no single resume item. In my internship with W.L. Gore, I met leaders in the company who came out of college with just their bachelor's, almost no extracurriculars, but just through hard work and having great skills with people and great passion for what they were doing, they moved up to regional leadership positions and managed a lot of people really well. I worked with engineers who came right out of college into industry and just built up their expertise, basically just working the jobs they got and continued to move up to. I met one guy who got his PhD in botany studying mushrooms, but then transitioned to material science years later. So it's really just about where you want to go and less about how you want to get there.
Right. Perfect. Thank you. That is really helpful as these students are kind of planning out their career path. So this next question is specifically for Sienna, Amanda, or Robert. Are there some common misconceptions about working in chemical engineering that you'd like to dispel?
Oh, you mean like we look at our shoes a lot?
Sure.
We don't look people in the eye. We like working on the bench. Don't work with people. I don't know if that really exists so much anymore, but I do want to add to my previous point, though, that whether you choose to get a master's or seek employment after undergraduate really depends on the company or organization and the opportunities you're presented. I know, but from my 3M experience, we have what's called a dual ladder, where you can come in and you can focus your career on the technical side and go up that technical ladder through promotions and such, all the way up to a corporate scientist, which is at the same pay grade as a vice president. Or if at some point you choose, well, I want to go to the management side of the dual ladder, you can progress up from supervisor to manager to director to VP to potentially being an executive VP. And the nice thing about that is, at least in 3M, you could bounce back and forth between the dual and between the technical and the managerial ladder quite often. In fact, I did that. That was my case. I bounced back and forth every maybe 5 to 8 years. I would go from one side to the other because I always wanted to stay grounded on the technical side and to keep pace with the advancements in that that technical community. But then once I had that enhanced knowledge, then I was comfortable moving back over to the manager side so I can share that with more broadly to my teams, my direct reports. And so it was a good balance. But as long as you've got good communication and interpersonal skills, I don't think it really matters what the old stereotypes are of an engineer versus a manager. You know, it's even worse was the stereotype between an engineer and a statistician. The funny humorous point was the comparison would be, well, when you're talking to an engineer, yeah, they look at your feet. But when you're talking to a statistician, he looks at his feet and talks about your feet. So, you know, the comparisons and data averaging. And
yeah. Gotcha. Well, thank you for that. Any other panelists want to respond to that one? Any common misconceptions you want to dispel?
I can only speak on the ASU program, obviously, because I go to ASU, but maybe this is not the same for every school. I was expecting a lot more chemistry when I first joined chemical engineering. Obviously, you know, you take organic chemistry and all those kinds of chemistries, but chemical engineering is a lot, at least at ASU, is a lot about, you know, pipes, separations, columns, pumps, you know, all that kind of stuff. So I was expecting more kind of like the synthesizing, Breaking Bad stereotypical of chemistry, of chemical engineering, which it's not necessarily, it doesn't make that a bad thing or anything. It just was a little bit different than what I was expecting, but there still is a lot of different applications, even though you are learning something in school versus what you can get a career in.
Yeah, thank you for that. That is helpful for students who chose this and may not know specifically what they'd be doing. So thank you for that. So the next question, this is for any of the panelists. How does travel factor into your role?
Well, again, working for a large company like 3M, because we are so global, there was quite a bit of travel involved. Maybe in your first few years, you're working on small local teams, scaling up products within manufacturing facilities in your own region. For example, if you're employed in the U.S., the travel would be working with teams to scale up products in some operation in the U.S. But then as you gain more credibility, you gain more exposure, as your career builds, you will find yourself working on products and scaling up new products and or processes that are cross country. We have a lot of global supply chains. So we have products that require 4 or 5 different manufacturing plants, because there are some processes that are in plant A, but not plant B, but then you've got to go from A to B and maybe to C. And you're not only crossing states, you're crossing into different countries, you're scaling up products in Southeast Asia or Latin America or Europe, and you're working with teams of people. And so again, communication and teamwork skills are very, very critical. So you can have anywhere, I would say toward the end of my career, when I was working at the corporate level, I could have traveled as much as 80%. I chose not to travel that much. But my general structure was, I would try to spend the summers in the United States. I would then, in the winter, I'd do all my traveling to Latin America. Obviously, it's their summer down there. And then in the spring, I would go to Southeast Asia, and in the fall, it would be Europe or vice versa. But I had a lot of travel toward the latter part of my career, just because I was working at that higher exposure level, and I was responsible for scaling up new operations, not just a product, not just a line, but getting entire manufacturing plants up and running.
Awesome. Thank you for that. That was really interesting to hear. Any other panelists have maybe a different experience with travel, or maybe not travel as much with your job?
I guess I would add that I don't travel at all for my job. We have several locations around the globe at Intel, but we do a really good job of working, I think, remotely. There's definitely people who, as they climb the ladder, have more opportunities to travel, just because their scope broadens beyond just the site, the local site. It also depends just on the company and the kind of role. Chemical engineering is really broad, and so you could theoretically go into industries like consulting, as opposed to manufacturing, where you might be traveling more. So that's just something to keep in mind. But I think most traditional chemi jobs, you probably won't travel a whole lot.
Perfect, thank you so much. And then this next question is specifically for Sienna and Amanda. How have you seen the field change for female engineers?
So since Amanda's on mute right now, I will answer that. It definitely has changed, I think, a little bit. I think we're making steps in the right direction, specifically as women as a population. I think we're getting out of the stereotype of, I'm a girl, I'm bad at math, which I think prevents a lot of people from going into engineering. So I'm glad that women are taking their, everyone necessarily doesn't have a great talent towards math. I sure didn't, but if you put enough work in and you put enough, time and hours, you can definitely develop those skills. There's definitely some places at my internship where there are still very, very few women engineers. I think last summer I only maybe saw one or two women that were in engineering there, which is unfortunate, but I think that's still kind of a scope of a lot of companies. I think now, at least in my graduating class, the seniors, there's about 50% of women, I would say, in my graduating class. So I think maybe as newer generations start to graduate, we'll see that shift change. But I think that it is changing for the better, and we're going to hopefully get some more diversity in a lot of different companies.
Yeah, I agree with that. I would definitely say that the situation continues to get better and better. I was really fortunate to go to a school that really valued women and underrepresented minority diversity in engineering specifically and in chemie, and I work for a company that also values it equally, if not more. So I also graduated with nearly 50-50 women in my class, and actually the team I work on now of 10 engineers is majority women. I think at the educational and entry level, there are a ton of resources for people, and companies are definitely emphasizing that shift. I think actually looking forward, the challenge for women might be further into their careers as they look to, you know, grow families and whatnot. But I definitely say it's a very positive environment for women, so.
All right. Thank you both for that. And so we have time for one more question. So this one is pretty relevant for our world right now. How has COVID-19 affected your jobs and projects? This is for anybody. If you could just give us a quick answer for that.
A lot of virtual meetings. Unfortunately, not as much opportunity for the physical social networking. So we try to make up for it using more of the virtual tools like Zoom and WebEx and others. And we try to build into an agenda. We try to carve out a time just to specifically promote networking and social engagement, but it's just not the same. We really do miss that one-on-one interaction, the traditional model, you know, the water cooler discussion, which probably most of you today don't have a clue what that even means, but even like a company like 3M, even pre-COVID, as we have new generations and new communication tools coming into the workplace, the preferred method of communicating shifted from, you know, the traditionalists and baby boomers. It was, well, we'll just come out of our offices or off of our lab benches. We'll meet for lunch. We'll have informal discussions at the water cooler in the hallway. To when I left 3M, it was already changing more toward the virtual environment where we would have Yammer, which was kind of like a Twitter or Facebook. We'd have a LinkedIn, we'd have all these different virtual tools trying to promote the cross-fertilization of ideas. And within 3M, we have a structure called the Tech Forum, which is all about bringing together the technical community, and they could choose to form special interest chapters or interest groups and just learn from one another. We could have chemical engineers and mechanical engineers and electrical engineers all with a certain passion or similar hobbies. And they would get together and they would learn from each other and bring some of those applications back into the workplace. But definitely with COVID, if there's the need to have more of that virtual networking, both structured to encourage and facilitate discussion around a topic, and the completely unstructured where there's no agenda, you just show up. We provide the space, whether it's a virtual space or a physical space, and there's no agenda. We're just bringing people together, and we need more of that.
All right. Well, thank you, Robert. And unfortunately, we have run out of time. Time flies when you're having fun. So on behalf of the Fulton Schools of Engineering, I would like to thank the panelists for their time and insight. Panelists, you're welcome to mute yourselves and listen to the next panel or to leave the meeting and make me the host if it prompts you to do so. Students, after a 3-minute break, we will start the next panel. Thank you. Thanks again.
All right. Hi, everyone. So we're going to start with the second panel now. Okay, so my name is Hannah. I'm going to be the moderator for the second panel this evening. I just want to start by thanking all of our panelists for taking time out of their evenings to be on our Chemical Engineering and Materials Science Career Exploration Night panel. So again, this if you couldn't tell by the recording sound, this event is being recorded and it'll be made available again to your ASU 101 instructors in a few days. In case you become closed out of this meeting or if your internet cuts out or anything, please just log in again and we will start our 5:30 to 6:30 panel now. So as the moderator, I'm going to start with a couple prepared questions directed to all of the panelists. Panelists, I'll use your name so you'll know the question is being directed towards you. If you would like to pass on answering a question at any time, please just feel free to say pass. You can also add or agree with somebody else's statement as well. Students, again, your attendance is being recorded based on your registration information and the length that you are in the meeting. The attendance list will be then given to your ASU 101 instructors. Please use that Q&A box again at the bottom of your Zoom bar. Type any career-related questions for our panelists. You can make up the questions or you can use questions from that workbook. If your question is directed to a specific panelist, please include their name in the question. So you can start typing those questions now. Our Q&A moderator will start reading them shortly. Okay, panelists. So please, I can see you guys have all taken yourself off mute, but please remain your video off. And let's begin. So the first question is for all the panelists to help the undergraduate first year student audience know a bit about you as they formulate their questions. Please give a minute or two of your elevator speech, professional tell me about yourself pitch, and include how your formal education is used in your current or previous roles. Let's start with Cindy.
Hello, everybody. My name is Cindy Raquel. I am a current senior in material science and engineering. My past experience includes being an undergraduate researcher in the 4D Center of Material Science through FURI. I was a failure analysis intern at Raytheon Technologies, California, and I'm currently a process engineering intern at Intel.
Perfect. Okay, and Alex?
Hello, my name is Alex Weisinger. I graduated from ASU with a degree in chemical engineering as well as philosophy back in the spring of 2016. I worked as a contractor for the Department of Defense and eventually worked for the government as a DoD engineer working in Yuma, Arizona at the Yuma Proving Grounds, working exclusively with explosive munitions, and eventually found my way at Northrop Grumman where I got offered a position to work as a material process engineer.
Thank you. All right, and Emily?
Hello, my name is Emily Nugent. So I did my undergrad degree at ASU in chemical engineering and finished in 2019. And then I did the 4+1 program and actually switched over to material science. And I did that and graduated this past May. So if you are in between those two or not really sure what the difference is, feel free to ask me. I feel like that was really important in my education. And I actually use, I would say, both of my degrees for my current job at NXP. So I use the chemical engineering to kind of look at the big picture and the process for developing our products. And then I use my material science for looking at defects and how we can improve the amount of output that we are selling and the quality of that output. While at ASU, I was super involved in a bunch of different organizations as well. So that's a little bit about me.
Thank you, Emily, and congrats on graduating.
Thanks.
All right, and Neil.
Thanks, Hannah. Hey, everyone. My name's Neil. Like Emily, I did the 4+1 program as well. I did my undergraduate and graduate degree in chemical engineering and just graduated this past May. So during my undergrad and grad school, I tried to involve myself in research. That was kind of, we can talk more about this later, but that was sort of my primary focus. And then during grad school, I interned at Intel as a process engineer. And now I am working at W.L. Gore & Associates up here in Flagstaff as a quality engineer.
Perfect. Well, congrats on graduating too.
Thank you.
All right. And so another question for all of our panelists. Please give us one piece of career advice or a career observation you'd like to ensure all of our students who also just started their ASU education a few weeks ago that you would like for them to hear. So let's start with Cindy again.
I guess one piece of advice for your career is be open to feedback and ask for help. I know my first conference I ever went to, which the Society of Hispanic Professional Engineership, I thought I really did have my stuff together and I did have a strong resume, but it wasn't until after the event. And I think I spent, even though I was sponsored at, and I was getting reimbursed afterwards, I did spend like $1,000 to travel out to Cleveland, which was a nice experience. But I feel like I could have been a lot more prepared if I had reached out and asked for help. And I think that's something I learned afterwards and something I applied. And that's the reason I did a lot better the next year with 7 interviews from the next conference I went to. So one thing I could say is like, be open to asking for help from older people and people that have done well. So, yeah.
Great, that's perfect. All right, and Alex?
I would say one of the best pieces of advice I could give for especially freshman engineers is, it's engineering is, it can be tough, it can be rough. There will be lots of times where you might question being an engineer, but I would say that to be a good and successful engineer, you need to kind of embrace the kind of difficulty of it and not be afraid of kind of opportunities as they get presented to you. I can say, at least from my experience at ASU, I know I kind of went down this kind of oddball path, I would say, where I know, Intel was always kind of the big one that, at least when I was there in, 2016 timeframe, that was kind of the big company that a lot of, my classmates wanted to work at, which obviously I did as well. But when I got an offer to, to move to Yuma, where I really never considered it, I kind of took it on a whim, figured why not? Sounds like it could be, fun and exciting. And it was actually a blast and I learned a lot. And it kind of made it so, when I met back with classmates and friends, I felt like some better stories and experiences than they were able to kind of say with their jobs that they took at their respective companies. So, I would just say definitely embrace those kind of opportunities if they come up and you're kind of like, well, I don't really know much about that. But if you think I do, like, go down that path and see where it kind of takes you. I think it's kind of a really rewarding kind of aspect as a student, I would say I never really wanted to fully embrace, but being a professional, I would say that that's given me the most professional growth.
Thank you, Alex. That's great advice. All right, and the same question for Emily.
So my advice would be don't shy away from something because people said it's hard. You're already in chemical engineering or material science. You don't need to add more barriers to yourself. People are always going to think what you're doing is hard, so don't use that as an excuse. I think that's something that held me back and made it hard for me to decide that material science was something that I was interested in just because I'd heard it was so hard. And that was kind of ridiculous now that I look back on it and going like, I could have done it like from the start. I think, they're both challenging programs, but both very interesting. And then my other one is tacking on to Alex, same thing where take the road less traveled. So one of my internships in undergrad was at Disney World for a year doing a non-technical internship. You might be like, that's a waste of your time. But really what I got out of it was so many interpersonal skills. And it really helped me actually end up getting a lot of interviews because they knew that I knew how to talk to people and that I'm really good with groups or convincing people to do certain things. And so I think, taking that path less traveled, like taking a year off and working for a company people don't expect, I think that that's just as valid as someone who takes a more traditional path.
Thank you. That's really interesting. All right, and Neil.
Yeah, sure. I have two quick ones, actually. So the first one, I would say, someone told me this, I think it was like my junior year of college. They told me to surround myself with people smarter than me, which I never really thought about. I always knew it was important to learn from those around you, but really, whether that's kind of people you're doing research with, classmates, even mentors outside of university, gaining those different perspectives from people who've been in your shoes and kind of someone you can talk to about any concerns you might have. I found that to be super critical. And now going into the workforce, I feel like I'm really trying my best to implement that. And then the second piece of advice is, you guys chose engineering, so it will get stressful, yes. It's definitely a rewarding path to be on, but find a way to deal with the stress. So for me, that was getting involved in intramural sports or going to the gym, just find a healthy outlet. Because I had a lot of classmates who got overwhelmed and they didn't know what to do. So they would just sort of, you know, get depressed and get sad. And it's, I'm making it sound a lot worse than it is, but just find that healthy outlet. It'll really pay off in the long run.
Thank you. I agree. Finding a healthy outlet is a great way to balance this. Mm-hmm. All right. So now we're going to open up to the audience questions. Everybody feel free to start asking those questions in that Q&A chat. We have one to start. It is directed for Alex. So Alex, how did you get involved with the DoD?
Well, it's going to be probably not as exciting of an answer, so I apologize, but it honestly was looking for a job before graduation, applying to just a random position where I said, that sounds like fun, and it just so happened to be what I thought was actually maybe a phony job description, because I didn't think you could actually do that for a job of blowing stuff up in the desert, supporting, you know, the military in that way, and lo and behold, I got a phone call. They flew me out and, you know, showed me the range, and I got to meet a bunch of the guys who had served overseas and people from all the different, you know, defense contracting companies that you've heard of, specifically with the Army. And the rest of it was kind of really as simple as that. It was just kind of saying yes. And the biggest requirement they still have is, and I'll just say it because I know a lot of my friends who had the dual citizenship or were from another country, it's a little tricky. They are very particular. There is no dual citizenships allowed. You have to be just an American citizen is the biggest one. And I would say that's your best bet. And for DoD in particular, don't be afraid going with a engineering contractor. If I remember correctly, I think Jacobs was still doing a decent amount of that at most of the facilities. There's a few other ones here and there. I know mine was Trax International, spelled T-R-A-X. Working with like a contractor that works under the DoD is a good way to kind of get your foot in the door to then a potential job with the DoD as a government employee later on.
Thank you. All right, so we have another question for the group. So this is for all panelists if you guys want to answer. If you did research in your undergraduate, what was the best way to get involved in the research and how did you start? You can start and just see if anybody wants to answer.
Yeah, I can take this one. So as far as research goes, being a freshman, you might seem intimidated by like just the thought of going to a lab with no experience and getting involved. But professors know that. And I think a lot of them, at least for me, I was able to get into a lab freshman year. It wasn't even a chemical engineering lab. It was a biomedical engineering lab. Because I emailed a professor that I thought did interesting work. And I kind of showed that initiative. And I think he appreciated that. And so don't be afraid to kind of cold call or cold email professors if you've, you know, done your research and know kind of what they're doing. And on the, I think the Fulton ASU webpage, they have all the faculty, what their lab does. So taking advantage of that resource is super helpful. So don't be afraid to kind of reach out as a freshman, because a lot of professors actually want younger students because you can develop skills in their lab throughout your 4 years or however many years your degree takes, right? So that's probably my biggest piece of advice. Just don't be afraid to reach out.
Perfect.
I guess building off that. Oh, sorry.
No, keep going.
But building off Neil's advice, I do recommend starting off as a freshman. That's one of my regrets. I think the scariest step is the first step, just cold emailing professors. How do you build an email? How do you seem respectful? You have a resume that you can attach to an email. How are you going to make yourself look good to a professor when you don't have experience? So I know like my first shot that I took for a lab, the professor told me she couldn't put me in consideration for a laboratory due to the fact that she was going on sabbatical. So that was a bit disheartening, but I did find another opportunity through being a section leader for Fulton. And I met the professor, and I did good work for him, and he saw that. And I asked him when we toured his lab, like, I think what you're doing is really cool. I would love to have an opportunity to take part in it. And he saw that I had potential, and that was my first experience. And I say that research is literally, or could be, the make or break when you're looking for an internship.
Thank you, Cindy. Mm-hmm. All right, Alex, Emily, do you guys have anything to tack on to that?
So I did research as well, and how I found my research is I had a friend in the research lab. I worked with Dr. Heather Emity. If you're in the chemical engineering program, you will definitely have at least one class with her. She's awesome. She's amazing. Definitely would consider her my mentor. I'm really glad I had the opportunity to work with her, and I found her through a friend, as I said, who was in her lab, but also I went to one of the AICHE or AICHE meetings. And she was presenting her research there, and so I was able to listen to it. And for me, like I talked about struggling with chemical engineering, there's so many areas of research, but I kind of knew that there's a lot I wasn't that interested in. And it turns out that her research I really enjoyed, and it's because it like bridged the gap between chemical engineering and material science. And yeah, I would say like, go ahead, cold email those professors. Some are going to reply, some aren't, just because they get so many emails. But, you know, don't take that, you know, rejection to heart. Just, you know, move on and see if there's other labs you're interested in. And they don't have to be within SEMTI. They can be in other areas in Fulton. They're always looking for people. So, yeah, I definitely agree with the other panelists.
Thank you, Emily. And Alex, do you have anything to add?
Nope, I was going to say they've all kind of taken all the best points that I can say right now about researching in your undergrad.
Perfect. All right. And so we have another question for all of the chemical engineers. What would you say is the hardest part about being a chemical engineer? And we can start with Alex.
I'll go, and I know I listened a little bit to the previous panel, and I'll say that a lot of the myths about chemical engineering is probably the biggest one. I can say personally at every company I've been at, as soon as you say you're a chemical engineer, they just assume that you're the best whiz kid on chemistry and that you know everything that a chemist with a PhD would know. And you quickly have to, you know, kind of thwart that and say, no, I have a decent understanding and chemistry doesn't scare me. But, you know, I really know a lot more when it comes to kind of fluid dynamics and thermodynamics and kind of other principles within kind of chemical engineering. But I would say that's probably the biggest kind of misconception of chemical engineering that I always feel like I have to address every interview, every time I meet a new manager, every time I get brought onto a new project. That's usually the first thing that gets brought up, especially when you work with a lot of mechanical engineers.
Thank you. That's good advice. Mm-hmm. All right, Emily?
I would say, yeah, really similar to that. I did listen to the last panel as well, reflecting on the chemical engineering isn't just chemistry, and that was like a big reason why I chose it. Overall, I actually feel like material science has some of those core chemical principles, but overall, kind of they just deal with different parts of the periodic table when I'm looking at the 2 degrees that I have. But that chemical engineering had a lot of process design, and what you're doing in school isn't necessarily all the jobs that are out there. There's a lot more opportunities in chemical engineering than just the process engineering that you learn in school, strictly. Yeah.
Thank you. And Neil?
Yeah, I would say kind of along a similar line. A lot of the jobs that you hear about, let's say, for example, I know Alex brought this up, because you're a chemical engineer at Arizona State University, Intel is going to be looking out for you when you graduate. They hire a lot of chemical engineers. But just know that your degree does not kind of constrain you to, you know, 3 or 4 roles. There's a bunch of chemical, I've heard this a lot from older chemical engineers. They never end up actually doing real chemical engineering work. They either end up as consultants or kind of design engineers. There's a lot of different routes you can take. So I'd say the most kind of important thing to look at there is what field interests you. And a lot of the times you might see some overlap between, oh, I have a degree in chemical engineering, how can I apply it to this company or this type of work? Like, for example, my interest was always with medicine. I wanted to be a doctor, wanted to go to med school. And then I decided my junior year, when I was studying for the MCAT, it was just way too much work. It was just crazy. So I'm like, okay, how can I combine my interest with engineering and medicine? And then I ended up at a company that does design medical devices. So just find that kind of niche. I know I kind of went off topic a bit, but yeah.
That's great. Yeah, combining your interests. Okay, and I have a question for Cindy. So what strategies and resources do you use to be successful in all your courses?
I think for material science specifically, since it is such a small major, and I know the first 2 years I use the tutoring center because, you know, those are the generic classes, calculus, chemistry, physics. But once you get into like your specialized classes, your junior and senior year, the resource that you're really going to depend on is the TAs, the professors, office hours. Don't be afraid to go and talk to them. It might be really beneficial. I know I was scared of one professor just because he seemed a little tough. He was always like, you guys need to do better. But in reality, when I was in a one-on-one, he was just like, I really hope you do well in my class. I just really sincerely want you all to do well. So you never know. Like, these opportunities of going to ask questions, asking for help might foster a relationship with professors. I know it has for me. I go to a professor, Professor Anwar, and I always went to him for advice. And while I was in my Raytheon internship, he passed along an opportunity for me to intern at Northrop Grumman. And I interviewed for them and I was under consideration for an internship with them. So build those relationships, go to those office hours. Trust me, professors are usually lonely in their office hours because nobody goes to them, but just go and talk and ask them, like, what did you do for your career? So yeah.
Thank you. That's great advice and that's perfect. All right. And so the next question is, what was, and this can be open to the panel, what was your biggest challenge in your first professional position?
I can take this one really quick. So I think my first real professional position was when I was interning at Intel as a process engineer. And man, they make that stuff so complicated. And it is for good reason. But just understand that I think my biggest issue was I felt like I had to know everything that was going on. But sometimes it's okay not to know. And just asking for help or asking questions is really crucial. So I think just kind of getting over that mental hurdle when you start a job can be difficult, but it'll definitely be helpful, you know, down the road. So, yeah.
Thank you. Does anybody else want to add to that?
Yeah, I can add on to it. It might be a little counter to Neil, but it's just due to the nature of this job. For my first professional job, I would say out of college, so once I graduated, obviously working with explosives, I had no background with it other than model rockets as a kid. So very big difference from watching rockets go up into the sky with a little cardboard tube, then seeing, you know, enough C4 to demolish a small tank. You kind of get a little freaked out by it, especially if you don't fully understand how some of this stuff kind of works, since, you know, didn't really have that background growing up as a, you know, in my family or anything like that. So it was kind of different, but unique. And I would say the biggest thing that I kind of learned, even though I was kind of terrified of these things that are obviously meant to do a job that you don't want to be around when it's actually doing its job, was to kind of trust in your kind of technicians or those that they might not be the formal degreed engineers, they might not be even your manager or a boss, or even someone that's higher up on like the command chain, but sometimes the people that would be, you know, your, you know, inferior, so to speak, they usually have lots of wisdom. Some of them have done the job for a very long time, and asking them questions and asking their opinions on, you know, operating procedures or the safety of certain things, helped me feel more at ease, and it also helped me earn the respect of them when I needed them to do things that were maybe not necessarily things that they wanted to do on a Sunday afternoon in 125 degree heat in the middle of the desert. So I would say that, yeah, I would say it's okay to ask questions, and it's not wrong to ask like a technician or someone that might have a little bit more experience than you doing maybe the actual labor of the job. Just kind of, you know, why are they doing it that way? You know, kind of their thoughts and opinions, and kind of use your best judgment as an engineer to take that feedback and then apply it then to your job. Because I think that helps make, you know, it makes the transition a bit easier, I think.
Thank you.
Hannah, could you repeat the question?
Yeah. So it was, and it just went away.
Oh, like, what challenge did you have in your first professional?
In the first professional position, yes.
I think when I went to Raytheon, I went to a completely different state. I'm a first generation Latina, I'm a female. It was the first time I took my car on a road trip. And it was my first time in a professional setting. I didn't know how to talk. I didn't know how to present myself. I didn't know what clothes to wear. So it's perfectly okay to not know, to be nervous, to be afraid, but reach out to people. I wish I had sooner. When I did reach out to my coworkers and told them I'm having a lot of trouble readjusting. It's a new state. I don't have family here. It's COVID. I don't know really what to do. I feel very lonely. They were really empathetic, and they really did help me out to make my experience the best it could be towards the end of my internship.
Thank you, Cindy. That's very relevant for right now. All right, and Emily, did you have something to add?
Yeah, I just want to say I definitely agree with Alex. Listen to the technicians. That's something that I learned kind of being the technician at Disney, was that you always felt more valued if the person with the technical role was asking you questions, because nobody knows how to do the job better than the person operating whatever it was. So at Disney, it was the rides. But yeah, basically to work with them. And then my other struggle is, or I would say like the other thing for me was my first internship where I was using those technical skills was at Cummins, which is a diesel engine company. If you're really into cars, you'll know who they are. If you aren't, don't worry about it. They make diesel engines. That's all you need to know. But at that job, I think what was important is, so I had interned at Disney before that, and I like fell in love with the company, and I loved living in Orlando, and I was like, oh my gosh, I can't wait to live in all these new states. And it turned out that I just really hated living in a small town in Indiana in the middle of nowhere. And so it's as much you're interviewing the company as they're interviewing you. You know, ask those questions, but also figure out, is this a company I wanted to work for? I mean, I love their values, I love my job, but I did not want to live in the middle of nowhere. And so I think that that's important as well to understand.
That is great advice. All right, and so kind of piggybacking off the Disney experience, we'll start with Emily on this question. Besides Disney, what other kinds of clubs or extracurriculars besides research do you think looks best on an application?
I definitely think professional organizations are really good. So like AICHE, Cindy, I know there's an equivalent for material science, but I never remember what it's called. But getting involved in those professional organizations, SWE as well, so Society of Women Engineers, anything where you're able to grow your network of other students as well as professionals. I know that my first internship I got from the SWE conference, or not at Disney, but my internship at Cummins I got from the SWE conference, and so those are really great opportunities. So outside of research, I think those are cool. And then if you can keep your grades up, that's always good. And then you can get selected to participate in certain organizations that are only available if you have like a high GPA or you're like in the top whatever percentile for your graduating class. So I was able to do that, and I got invited into Tau Beta Pi, which is a professional organization, not like a Greek organization at all, like not not Greek life. It's different than that. It just happens to have three Greek letters for the name. But I was involved in Greek life. But anyway, so Tau Beta Pi looked really good. So as soon as people saw, oh, you're like the top of your class, that you were into this, you were invited into this organization, that looked really good too. So I think it was like a good balance of being involved in extracurriculars and then also keeping up my GPA that, you know, once I had those leadership positions and such, that really helped me with getting jobs and internships.
Thank you. And Cindy, same question. What kind of clubs or extracurriculars as a current student do you think are very beneficial besides research when on an application?
Oh, especially societies like the Society of Hispanic Professional Engineers, SWE, SAES, BME Club. All those other clubs, I think they're really essential just because of the networking opportunities and the leadership positions you could take on. I know if I had not met SHIP, I would not have had my friends. I would not have the leadership experience I had. I'd never held a leadership position ever in the past just because I could never, I didn't have the resources. So when I got to college, I was like, there's no excuse. I literally live in the dorms. I can like go to every single club meeting. And so I went. I was scared to take on a leadership position, but when someone told me like, hey, I think you would be a really great leader, that really inspired me and empowered me to pursue outreach director. And from there, I had to learn how to be a good leader, how to be a team player. And then from there, I went to vice president and I learned how to be more professional. And it really did help me when I went to go pursue an internship. It did make me more confident. And now as president, it's made me a really well-rounded person. And now that I interview with people, this is actually really funny, but I got a call from Honeywell and they were telling me we would love to interview right now. Are you free? And I'm like, yeah, of course. And I was just like, I'm wondering how you got my resume. And they're just like, well, the SHIP president from this like 1986, I think it was, is actually our manager. And he saw that SHIP was on your resume. You're a vice president, and I'm pretty sure you're going to be a president soon. So he thought you would be a great candidate for the position, and we think you're a really great candidate. And after the interview, they gave me an on-the-spot internship offer. So like, these network opportunities are so strong. People always ask me, should I actually spend those $200 to go to a conference, or spend $500 to go to maybe California or Pennsylvania? Do it. The networking opportunities are absolutely phenomenal.
Thank you. That's really good advice. Networking and leadership skills are big. Great. Okay, so we have another question. So this is for all the panelists, and it's your opinion. So we'll start with Cindy. Do you think graduate school greatly improves or would improve future job prospects?
I know definitely having a master's or a PhD would improve prospects, but also be confident in what you want to do. When I did research, I was like, oh my goodness, this is tough. I'm in a room. I have this one assignment. I have to motivate myself to go in every single day. I was putting in extra hours. And I discovered I did not like the research setting. I did not like being alone. I did not like, I felt it was just soul crushing. So I knew that I wanted to go into the industry and work as a team. And that was always my pitch to every person that I was talking to. I was like, I want to work in a team. I want to work with people. I want to talk to people. I'm like, I can do individual assignments to contribute to the team, but I want to work with people. And so I've taken a decision of not pursuing a master's at this time because I haven't found that one topic I'm absolutely in love with, and that's okay. And if I plan to get my master's maybe in the future, but if you want to get it right away, I do think it does give an amazing opportunity. I think Emily can elaborate more since she did do the 4+1 program in material science, but in my prospect, I do think it does help, but I just want to allow myself the time to explore the industry and be confident in my decision in the future.
Thank you, Cindy. And so we will pass it on to Emily. Do you think that graduate school greatly improved your job's prospects?
I really do. I know the job that I have right now actually required, like, I think they wanted 5 or more years of experience, and I just had my one summer internship that was technical, and then my +1 master's, and I think without having that master's, I wouldn't have gotten hired into this position. And so, like, the other people that are younger or new hires were people who had worked in other industries or had worked previously for other companies if they didn't have a master's. And I just found that overall, for what I wanted to do, and this doesn't mean for what everybody wants to do, but for what I wanted to do, like, everything required previous experience. And it also just helped me get a leg up, because there's not that many, like there are entry level positions, but you're fighting against everyone else who's also graduating that. And so if you have that master's degree, it can just help a little bit more to be able to do, you know, get into that position that you're interested in. Going off of what Cindy said about kind of knowing what I wanted, I knew that I wanted to do material science and not chemical engineering, but I wasn't totally sure exactly what areas I wanted to do, but I still felt like with the plus one program, because I was able to take some graduate classes before I actually graduated from my undergrad, I was able to kind of figure out and answer those questions for myself. So that's my analysis of that. Yep, thank you.
Thank you. And Neil, since you also graduated from the 4+1, do you have any opinions on this?
Yeah, so I think my main rationale for doing my master's degree through this program, I think it was because I felt like I personally needed more time to explore exactly what I wanted to do. I think that's also an important consideration to make, because I think Cindy was touching on this, but rushing into a job isn't really, obviously you have financial reasons for doing it, but kind of taking that time to figure out what you want to do kind of led me into doing my master's, alongside me realizing that if I did want to do graduate school eventually, I would have to come back after a few years, and that might be difficult, you know, because might have a family, might be deep into your work. It can be hard to balance those two things, work and graduate school. So I thought doing it right off the bat would be a good idea. And I think the question was, does it pose any advantages, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I would say it did help me secure the current role I'm in, because I think Emily touched on this. She was talking about how you're in a pool of applicants, and you want to do everything you can to differentiate yourself. By having that master's degree, having kind of a little bit more depth of expertise in your field or a certain sector of your field, it can help. So I think if you want to get more technical, a master's can help. If you want more time to figure out what you want to do, a master's can help. But you also have to think long term, right? So do you see yourself going back to school after you're working and things like that? Yeah, that's sort of my thought process going into the 4+1.
Thank you.
Can I add something onto what Neil said?
Of course.
Yeah, I definitely heard from a lot of people, like, if you can do your master's now, do it now. And I can confirm that that was really good, because right now I'm studying for my engineering license, but like the first step for it. And it's really hard to work and then get myself to go study after work. So I would definitely recommend it. Like, I plan to take it at the end of summer, like in August I was going to take it, and I'm still studying for it and hopefully taking it by December, just because it's hard to get yourself to do studying after work, you know.
Yeah, different mindsets.
Yeah, definitely, definitely.
Thank you. All right, and so there's another question. It's for any panelist that wants to answer it. Do any of you foresee any new fields or concentrations coming from chemical engineering or material science that look promising in the near future? So anything, do you think anything is going to stem off from chemical or material science that looks promising for students?
The big thing that I have heard about in multiple industries is more for the material science side, but 3D printing metals and being able to figure out how you can do that so that you can, you know, print a wrench or whatever it is you want right away. And so that's kind of the next step in that direction that I have seen and heard of. I'm not as attuned to chemical engineering, so I'm gonna let someone else answer that part.
I think for material science, something that I heard Professor Tange mention, Seth, he mentioned quantum mechanics of materials. Like, that is a new field that is emerging because the government has made it a new initiative. I'm not very familiar with it, but I know that's something that is coming out of material science.
I think for chemical engineering, you'll see this in your studies too, but a large focus of chemical engineering revolves around energy. So I think as we move away from fossil fuels, there's going to be a lot more emphasis on developing technology, like clean technology. A lot of my research was with algae as a carbon neutral biofuel. So that's in its kind of development stages, but things like that, I think, could definitely develop as you guys start to graduate and you see these jobs kind of out there. So.
Thank you. All right, another question. Are there any cybersecurity elements, or do you have any, do you have to be cyber aware in your current position? You can start with Alex.
I'll simply just say yes. It's maybe the most important part of the job. I mean, like even referring to like the previous, I mean, there's multiple that I'm aware of, but I'm not at liberty to really say too much on, other than I will agree with Emily with additive manufacturing is kind of the new buzzword in the industry. But in terms of cybersecurity, you do need to be very mindful and aware. I mean, so much so that, you know, I remember in when I was in school thinking that, you know, having like the smartwatch was kind of a cool thing and being able to have your phone on you. And here I am with a pager that is a one-way only pager because I'm not allowed to bring a phone into work. You know, my email gets monitored. I have to go onto like four different computers and go into special areas just to send information that, you know, when I first started, I thought was really kind of like, really? This is what I need all this extra security for with the armed guards outside? Like, really? But, you know, you have to follow protocols, and it's obviously very important in aerospace and defense as a whole.
Thank you. Emily, same question.
I would say yes, but I don't have it to the same level that Alex does, since probably more just like proprietary information is important. So I can't be like to my Intel friends, this is what we're making at NXP, you know, like there's proprietary information. I think that just want to address like another side of the cybersecurity question, just in case other people have it. I do think that, like, so I chose chemical engineering because I didn't want to code and I wasn't good at it. But that it is important and good to actually know how to code or understand some of those basic languages, because you can better understand how your programs work. And I just want to touch on that in case there's like another edge to the cybersecurity, but I don't really deal with it that much. Like somebody else does that for me. That's behind the scenes. So
thank you. Back to that, Emily, what coding languages do you use at your job?
So somebody else does code for me, but I was really afraid to learn coding. I took MATLAB in school as part of FSC 100. I'm sure a lot of you have started using that in your course, and then you'll use it again in differential equations. And that was kind of really all we did with chemical engineering. And I was just so afraid to take it. So actually this past summer, I challenged myself to take C++ and was like, you know, if I fail, I fail, but it's not gonna affect my GPA. And I actually like did really well at it. So just knowing C++, even if I'm not coding, but understanding the logic used, I actually understand a lot more of the like automatic manufacturing that's going on. So I understand like why it's going to this step, or like they're using if statements and how that works. That's really helpful. So that's what I would put out there in general, but it's not a requirement for my job. I've just found that it really helped me better understand it.
Thank you. All right, and another question for all the panelists, and I'll just go down in order. What is your favorite part about your job or internship? We'll start with Cindy.
I guess my favorite part of my internship is the environment. For both Raytheon and Intel. My bosses are super understanding. They understand I'm an intern, I don't know much, so they're more than happy to help me out. I remember the first time I showed up at Raytheon. Usually people, the company will give you like a buddy system, and it's really, really great, and they will help you through the transition to the professional field, and it will help you adjust, and they're more than happy to help you out. So it is very important for you guys to ask questions to the company. What support system do you provide? What is your environment like? Because you also want to be a good fit and personality with their team. So yeah, like that's my answer.
Thank you. All right, and Alex?
I would say one of my favorite parts of the job is currently. One, it's cool being able to go to an Air Force an airfield every single day, seeing all the different, you know, kind of aircraft that I get to work with, and being able to, at times when I go down to downtown LA, where some of our other kind of test facilities are, being able to, now obviously it's not really there anymore, but it was, but like the James West Telescope or James Webb Telescope was there, JWST, being able to see like kind of all the cool things that Northrop is kind of involved in has been really cool. And has been like obviously one of my favorite parts. I'd say the other one though is also kind of working for a larger company is really kind of, at least with my current role, I get to talk to a lot of different suppliers and manufacturers, and you know, these were, I would say some of these are more the chemical engineering kind of jobs, and being able to talk with, you know, guys who have been working 25 plus years at, you know, 3M or at Solvay working with like composite. And being able to kind of pick their brains and kind of, you kind of network with them to kind of understand their needs and the market and whatnot. But it's also just kind of fun knowing that you kind of have your work mission, but you also have, you know, kind of these other players around you that help you, and you kind of realize how many people it really takes to make that super cool, you know, B-2 bomber that we make, realizing how many hundreds of companies and engineers are required to make it so that thing can fly through the sky, undetected it's kind of amazing. But I would say like those are kind of my favorite things about my current role.
Thank you. And Emily?
So I didn't totally touch on exactly what I do at NXP, but the products we make end up going into cars to make them smarter, such as like self-driving cars is, you know, the future. But, I guess I should have said that. That's definitely what my industry is going towards, is helping self-driving cars. But anyway, so the chips that we make go into your car to like help detect the car in front of you, make sure that your airbag goes off, detect that lane departure. And so I really like it because I know that what I'm doing is helping to make people safe and making a difference in their daily lives. So I think that that's like really cool. And that's what makes me interested in my job. And then I like that it combines my favorite parts of chemical engineering and material science engineering. So I get, you know, the best of both worlds, the parts I didn't so much like of chemical, I don't really do. So I really like that I have that opportunity. Yeah.
Thank you, Emily. All right, and Neil?
Yeah, sure. So kind of combining Cindy and Emily's answers, I think for me, I love my current role because one, the company culture is so just like inclusive and so focused on developing individual kind of learning, and it's not like a hierarchical structure like a lot of large corporations are. They have like, they call it like their lattice, so everyone's on kind of this lattice, and they encourage you to, you know, network and reach out to anyone. So having that flexibility, I really enjoy. And then second is what Emily was kind of talking about, is the work you do really kind of keeps you motivated. Like even if the day-to-day work is boring and tedious, just knowing that, at least in my role, kind of developing these and allowing these medical devices to reach certain populations to help people is what kind of reminds me that what I'm doing matters, and it's not just, you know, needless Excel work or whatever I'm doing on that day. So yeah.
Thank you. All right, and so we have another question. This again is for everybody. So we'll start with Cindy. What does your company look for when hiring interns? So since you have been an intern very recently, for you, what did the company look for and value when you were interviewing?
It's funny, actually. I just got a random phone call from Intel, and I thought I would get another interview, but it was just one interview. And basically it was a very informal call. My boss actually called me and he was like, "Hello, am I speaking to Cindy?" And I'm like, "Yeah, this is me." And so we just started talking. He started talking about like his like background. And I was like, "Oh, well, this is my background." And he's like, "Are you interested in an internship?" And I was like, "Yeah." And then he just started asking me questions about my life, my extracurriculars. And I think one thing that really stood out is that I told him, I love what I'm doing every single day. Yes, my schedule is packed. I have a part-time job. Well, I had two. I have two, actually. I have SHIP. I'm the president. And I have school. And I am doing a lot of units. And he's just like, how do you do it? Like, how do you keep yourself so motivated? And I'm like, I love what I do, and I do it well. And I really want to learn from it. And I think that's something he really loved. And then the next thing he said was like, I would like to consider you for this position. Would you like it? And I was like, yes, of course. And I was actually surprised the next week. I was just waiting for another interview. And they were just like, you have the job. Report this day, this time. And I'm like, that's amazing. So I guess like the most important thing is that you're motivated and you show that you have the skills and the charisma and the personality that will fit in their team.
Thank you. That's great advice. Mm-hmm. All right. And Alex, what does your company look for when hiring interns, if you know?
So I actually help with picking some of the interns.
Perfect.
Every year. Yeah, so I've read too many resumes to count at this point. But I would say some of the things that we look for when we're hiring interns, you know, obviously, and I feel bad saying GPA because I know when I was in school, I know I used to hate hearing that as an answer. But we do look a little bit at your GPA, but mostly we're trying to look for kind of whether it was relevant classes that kind of show that you're kind of leaning towards, you know, for instance, with Northrop, we're looking to see if you're looking to work in aerospace, either in the aeronautics side, which is kind of military aircraft, or if you're looking to more, you know, be on the space side, or if you're looking to even do stuff with like our radar systems, stuff like that. So we kind of try to get like a feel based on the resume, based on the clubs, activities. If you've done any kind of DIY projects, feel free to put them on there. We had a kid at one point write down, you know, he was really big into playing the clarinet. And I mean, that made a VP very happy to hear, you know, about someone who was very into jazz music. So he had someone that he could talk to. And it gave him, you know, a huge boost when a lot of us kind of were like, really? Like, you know, jazz, really? Out of all the things, that's what did it. You know, so kind of just like, you know, adding that little bit of personality where you're no longer just, and this is something I got asked in my art, you know, back in the DOD days, where I'll never forget a general asking me when I was doing the government position role, asking me, your resume looks great, what do you do that a robot can't? And I remember that kind of stuck with me a bit. And I know that's more for a full-time job and not necessarily for an internship. But being able to put those things that show, why should I take you over Wikipedia or Google or, you know, the next greatest kind of Einstein or something, you know, what makes you unique in terms of your interpersonal skills? Do you have a passion for aircraft where you've been, you know, ever since you heard of the SR-71 Blackbird, you were like, that's what I want to work on and that's what I want to do. I want to work on the next one of those. Those are the things that we look for when we're hiring interns. Because that drive, I mean, there'll be those mundane days at the office and we need you to have that drive where you can kind of see the big picture and not just the individual day.
That is great advice. Thank you, Alex, so much. Mm-hmm. All right, and Emily, what does your company look for when hiring interns?
So I'm not going to speak for my company because I have yet to hire an intern and I didn't intern there, but I did interview a ton this past year looking for a full-time position, so I could just give some general information and a little bit about how I got this job that I think set me aside. So in general, definitely what Alex said, where it's like be personable, the number of interviews that I got asked, what do you do outside of engineering? What do you do for fun? Was like more than, I would say at least 2/3 of the interviews I had, they asked me that. And so like, they want you to have a life outside of engineering. So I was like, yeah, I love painting in my free time. That's like one of my favorite things to do is to paint. And so, you know, you can be a person outside of like typical engineering. And, you know, if you're like, oh, I like to make animatronics in my free time, then that's cool. That's what you like to do. But it doesn't have to be like, I just like to study. So I think that it's good to show you're involved. I know for my company, so Alex was saying about them wanting to look to see if you're interested. So I'm in the semiconductor industry, and you're going to have so many opportunities to take as many semiconductor classes, whether you're in material science or chemical engineering, that you would like to take, because it is such a big industry here in the Valley. And so my company, NXP, they make semiconductors as well. So just like Intel does, and honestly, at least like 10 other companies, but they were like, have you taken any semiconductor classes? And I hadn't, because I had kind of written off the industry. It's the same industry my dad worked in, and I just wanted to do something different. I'm a third generation engineer. I just wanted to be different. And so I had honestly written it off and didn't want to do anything. So when they interviewed me, they're like, why didn't you take anything? And I was like, I wanted to like see other areas. And my current boss honestly was about to reject me in the first interview and was like, well, you're not really interested in semiconductor work. Like, you don't have it. And I honestly just spoke up and was like, you know, even though I didn't take all those classes, I'm a good learner. I can learn like anything. Like, that's what my engineering degree has taught me. And I believe that, you know, if you put me to the test, I would be great for that. And that's actually like why I got hired. I learned later on was because I, you know, stood up and was like, I can do this. Like, give me a chance and I'll do it. And so I think, you know, having that confidence that if I don't know I don't know everything, but I'm willing to learn, I'm great at working with people. That's like always a great way to sell yourself. So those are things that I think just in general help, but I'm really not sure what my company looks for. Not yet, at least.
Thank you, Emily. All right. And we are just about out of time. So we're going to wrap it up with Neil. So same question. Do you know what your company looks for in interns?
Yeah. So I think the biggest, there's two things. So you really have to kind of, when they're interviewing you, there's a certain, I kind of spoke about this earlier, but there's a certain kind of culture, each company has. They want to see if you're a good fit for the culture. So being a, like a, being able to hold a good conversation, practicing interviewing, all those different things factor into, landing that internship. So the first thing I would say is, yeah, you have your GPA. Yeah, you're an engineer, or you're studying to be an engineer. And they know that. They know you probably can have the skills to succeed in that role, but they're also looking to see if you would be a good fit for the company. So that's a huge consideration. And then secondly, depending on the industry, this definitely varies, but for Gore, they look to see if you're passionate about wanting to kind of change people's lives through, in my division, it's medicine, right? So that is a pretty big kind of talking point and consideration they make when looking at different candidates for internships. Because ultimately, at the end of the day, all these companies want to convert their interns to full-time. That's just kind of the best thing to do from a business standpoint, like a time standpoint, et cetera. So I say those two things are the biggest thing that Gore looks for. I don't want to drag on any longer. I know we're out of time. So.
No, that's perfect. Thank you, Neil. And so, so we are now out of time for this panel group. I just want to say on behalf of the Fulton School of Engineering, I'd like to thank all the panelists for their time this evening and all of their insight and wonderful advice. Students, be sure to take that Career Exploration Night survey. It's on page 3 of your workbook. The recording will be available in a couple of days through your ASU 101 course. So please go ahead and you can log out of the webinar now. Thank you guys and good night.
Thank you.